Hey everyone, welcome back to the 2016 Bass Camp here at Warwick in Germany. Right now we're catching up with Kai Eckhardt. Kai.
Hey Nick, how's it going?
Good, thanks so much for coming by.
My pleasure.
And we just wanted to touch base with you and see what's been going on right now. What's keeping you busy at the moment?
Well, starting with the most recent thing, I had a concert with my band, the Kai Eckhardt Band,
okay. And
we had a special guest, Stanley Jordan, if you may know him,
Great, yeah. The
guitar player. He was actually playing guitar and piano at the same time, if you believe it,
okay. Sat
in with us. And I'm basically about to kick off this new band and make it to Europe for the first time.
Right.
So we're currently looking at 2017 to see if we can get an anchor date. And then around the anchor date, we can make our first little tour. Other than that, I'm currently starting a new channel, a bass channel called Alternative Bass. It's going to be linked to my website, you know, with teaching and some interviews, and some commentaries. And also I've been quite busy with clinics this year. And So other than that, I have my two children right now to raise. You know, I'm married, living in California, in Berkeley. And I have one child in high school, Naima, my 16-year-old, and Danilo, my 20-year-old, is at Laney College. That pretty much sums it up for the introduction.
Okay. So you're keeping busy, it sounds like. Can you... It's quite a broad question, but how would you describe your approach to the bass guitar, and how has it changed over the years, would you say?
Well, you know, there's always a known factor and an unknown factor. You know, the known factor is the sum total of everything that I've studied.
Right.
I actually started teaching myself and playing in rock bands back in Germany, and then from that I went into understanding more about other styles of music. We used to listen to AFN a lot, you know, American Forces Network, like
sure,
the radio from the Army, you know, the US Army base. So, you know, and I started to listen to Earth, Wind & Fire, and from that I went into Weather Report, Stanley Clark, you know, the fusion. And then Berklee College of Music, you know, with formal studies. And after that was the touring, a lot of touring with different bands, you know, also meeting different cultures. Specifically, I've went to India a few times and also to the Middle East, you know, working with Middle Eastern musicians. So all of that, of course, informs who I am today. And I try to find a synthesis, you know. In other words, if I look at two different cultural influences, I try to compare them and saying, how are they the same and how are they different? And if you look at the things that are unanimous to both of them, it gets you closer to the root of all music. Because I think the ultimate goal is to find the deepest roots and then to connect that to the furthest fringes, you know, that's sort of like the ultimate goal, is to get a harmonious impression of how does all this complexity we have in life relate to one common core. This is quite challenging, you know, because it can get very confusing, you know, navigating in and out of cultures, you know, what's accepted here is not accepted there and vice versa. So with my new channel, Alternative Bass, I try to do exactly that, is to find the pathway from complexity back to simplicity. So that's how I look at rhythm currently. What's the simplest rhythm and what's the most complex thing I know? And is there a pathway, you know, that you can take like an elevator going from one to the other? Same with harmony, you know.
That's quite a cool concept. How do you then take that into the mechanics of actually playing the bass and getting your technique and kind of working it that way, you know?
Right.
How does that come around?
Right.
What do you want?
Like, I'll just give you a quick
I mean, you have to translate that onto the guitar at some point, right? That concept.
Right, yeah. So for instance, if I take this concept and I apply it to harmony.
Uh-huh.
So I first look for the simplest. What is the simplest harmony? Well, you have a tone, right? So an individual tone like this is already composed of smaller parts, which are the fundamental, the harmonics, you know, so multiple tones are ringing just by hitting one string. And there is a certain harmonic concept already present, and it's called the harmonic overtone series. So it's like, if you're looking at it in terms of function of harmony, it's like the root, the root, the fifth, the root, right? Like it starts with the lowest note, and then they get higher and higher, right? Then it's the three, the five, the flat seven, the root, the two, the three, the sharp four, the five, the six, the flat seven, the natural seven, and then the root again. So those are 16 notes that are vibrating by just doing this. So you see, like for instance, here's one, right? Here you can hear the third. You know, actually this is the fifth, sorry. This is the third. Here's the flat seven. Here's the nine. Ah! You see what I'm saying? So then I go to that and I'm like, well, if I take these notes and make a scale out of it, what is it, right? Then I get to this. So it's the Lydian flat seven scale. So that means the Lydian flat seven scale is the most natural scale on planet Earth because of the way that the atmosphere vibrates and creates harmonics. You see what I'm saying?
Sure.
So that's one way to look at scales. And then from there on, you go, okay, now how does that connect to other scales and other modes? And, you know, so you have, again, the simple concept, and now you're branching out to complexity. Okay, one more example. Suppose you do the same thing with classical harmony that is made up of intervals, right? Like the smallest harmony is two notes at the same time, right? So let's say if I have a fifth, you know, it's two notes. Now, when what I do is I go, okay, then how many intervals are there? If intervals are the smallest elements, there's 12 intervals. So why don't I make an exercise for each of the intervals just to train them and nothing else? So it's kind of almost like you're taking the rainbow and you're trying to extract the pure colors and do a rudiment for each color. So it starts like this, and I'll be, okay, the smallest interval is, let's say, you know, right? It's the chromatic scale. And then I'll go. The next one is the whole tone scale. And then you go, you always add one element to it, then you go. Now the minor third, then. Right, then fourth.
Okay.
So I go all the way to like major sevenths, which is kind of like, you see, this type of stuff. So, of course, you gotta study this, and then there's always the process of, here's the concept, and now you're going into repetition. You know, endless repetition. You know, I usually do like 5 minute intervals, go take a break, come back, do 5 minutes more, until I have the rudiment down, and then I can get to the next level, that is, now let me marry intervals to each other and create designer scales from them. So let's say, for instance, here is one of those patterns. Let's say like something like this. You see how it's not a scale, it's not an arpeggio. It's a kind of marriage of different intervals, but they make up sounds that are really interesting to the ear. It's just not familiar sounds. And that's what I really like, you know? When I come out of the shed with something that I've never played before, and it's mystifying to me, you know, that keeps me going. Because there's always the danger in art of repeating yourself. And that is a little bit of an issue when, especially when you're a successful musician. And I used to play with John McLaughlin, and he always used to say, success is more dangerous than failure. Success is more dangerous than failure. You know, part of me was like, you know what, I'd much rather have the success than the failure. Thank you very much. But I understand, spiritually speaking, what he's talking about. Because suppose you are known for being the bass player in this famous band, you know, bass player in Queen or something. Everyone wants you to play Queen, right? Can you play this song? Or if you were, you know, Marcus Miller and you put out a slap video and everyone is into that pattern, they want to hear what they used to. But you, if you are Marcus Miller or if you are the bass player in Queen, there is a point where your consciousness is going to be like, you've already done this. Why do you keep doing this over and over again? Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
So there is, again, this mysterious thing about spiritual evolution where you have two conflicting, apparently conflicting principles. One of them is saying, don't ever repeat yourself. And the other one is, keep it consistent, keep it consistent. You see what I'm saying?
Sure.
And that's the puzzle right there. Can it be both at the same time? It should be, because if you can find a way to be totally consistent and never repeat yourself at the same time, you evolve, you know, which means you're like a happy person, you are curious about life, even though you might be an older person already, but you don't lose your childlike curiosity, which keeps you alive and healthy, you know? And it's not childish, you know? Childish is like if you're hanging on to ways that are like, well, you know, immaturity.
Sure.
But childlike is children have this like, hey, Aunt Christisch. Children have this just sort of like this way of engaging with the universe in a very pure and direct way, you know?
Right.
And I try to retain that as much as possible and also find a way to incorporate that in the teaching, yeah, so that a bass lesson is not only learning the instrument, it also could maybe help someone get through their day, you know,
right?
Because we all are in a situation that often is scary, complex, ups and downs, you know, financial problems, health problems, crazy society things going on, you know. So we're all in this, embedded in this. But I believe that at the center of everything, there is the eye of the hurricane. That you have within yourself a center that you can always access at will, where there is complete calm and you're at the center of everything and everything rotates around you, but you're not touched by it. And that's a great place to be when things get super challenging. And so music is a good way to get there, you know? So let's say sometimes I will just play a groove, like say something like this, if I go like. See how at the same time you have a complex pattern, it's like, what are these notes, right? What the heck is he doing? But the main thing I'm trying to communicate is just a sense of like,
yes.
You know what I'm saying? Like, it's peaceful, it's powerful and direct, but it's not abrasive, you know? It's supposed to be kind of like giving you a sense of, wow, you know, everything's okay. Don't worry, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I think that's my job as a musician, is to somehow find a way to articulate that in the world. Because I see what's going on around us, you know? Mm-hmm. And so music should be, you know, a messenger from a deeper place that tells you that, you know, no matter what happens, it's a good day, man,
sure.
You know?
Yeah.
And you are invincible at the core, no matter what happens.
And when it comes to applying some of those ideas on the bass,
mm-hmm.
you obviously need to have a certain level of technique
Yes.
To be able to do that, right?
Exactly.
For guys who want to improve their technique or work on that aspect of their playing, what would you recommend as a good direction?
Well, you know, I would actually recommend them to go to my website and join this 108-day program. Uh-huh. And I, you know, some people here actually have done it before.
Right. Okay.
And the reason is because when you're a young, or you know, it doesn't have to be a young person, but any person who's learning the bass, if you're studying by yourself, you're gonna at one point run into some difficulties.
Yeah.
And it's usually right before you make some kind of breakthrough. And so if you have a guidance at that point, somebody that says, don't give up, you're doing the right thing, you know, and you have a daily routine that you do, but that has enough flexibility for you to branch out and to explore, I think that's the best way. You know, let's say if you put it in a nutshell, there's always the element of cognition of the material that you're trying to learn. There's already the first level of possible confusion. If you're like, okay, I'm trying to learn the Lydian flat 7 scale. Oh, but I also like Mixolydian flat 13. So now you have two different ideas. What are you going to do first? So you might be working on this for a few minutes, but then you go, oh, I miss working on this one, and you jump back to this one. Potentially, you never learn anything, because the moment you get to a level of depth with your information, this other thing is there going like, hey, what about me? So a lot of times we skim the surface, you know, and we never get deep. And you have to go super deep to get to the place where, you know, like you're playing emotes, you know. And so you as a, let's say, if you're teaching yourself, you have to take a small amount of material and literally nurse that into existence until you're at a point where it's second nature. And there's a good test. So, for instance, if you want to know, am I ready to learn something else, you know, am I ready with this particular information here to say it's in my long-term memory? And the test is when you practice your exercise and you put down your instrument and leave and forget about what you did, and you come back, pick up your instrument, and you hit it right away flawlessly. That's an indication that you have it. Because when you're in a context of improvisation, suppose you're on the bandstand and you're jamming with musicians, the only information you can access is the information that requires only one command. So suppose I want to play a diminished scale in a particular jam context. It's just one thought, like, diminished, and my hand goes boom, 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 and does it in time. If I go diminished and there's just one split second of doubt, was it this finger, was it this finger, how was it again? I'm derailed already. So you see, what happens is you take a group of individual notes, you bundle them together in an exercise, you repeat, repeat, repeat. You go away, you come back, you go away, you come back. Now you're coming back and it's there for you instantly.
Sure.
Now this bundle of notes in your mind is stored as a single unified, it has a single address, yeah, like a URL. Mm-hmm. So you point your inner browser, right, to use a metaphor, you point your inner browser to this one URL, and there it opens up this website, and there is that scale coming out.
Sure.
You see?
Yeah.
And so this keeps going, you know. The next thing is, can you take that scale and move it around in different keys? That's the next level of complexity. So you shed that, and then that becomes a package. So it's now you have this scale in these keys. Boom, right? So that's how improvisation works. It's never that someone goes, oh, I'm such a genius. You know, I just get it from the universe. Here it comes, you know, I'm God's gift to music, blah, you know. It's usually hard work, and then the understanding of how to be organized with your knowledge and to have it at your display whenever you need it instantly, you see?
Yeah.
So it's a real process, you know, and it's hard work. The last thing I'll say is we have to watch out with technology, because technology gives us the illusion that we're evolving, but we're actually not. We're trusting our evolutionary process to an algorithm. And if the algorithm is super, super sophisticated, then it makes us feel like we have evolved. But you know, you just have to unplug the machine and now you're like, wow, what do I have now left, you know?
Sure.
So I think in the digital age of artificial intelligence, we have to make an extra effort as community and musicians to come together and to work with the human element that is unique to our experience, and not to get fooled by the appearance, you know, of flashy machines and you know, samples and that whole world.
Okay.
All right, that's I guess that kind of puts it in a nutshell.
Okay, the last thing I want to touch on really is your relationship with Warwick and the company. You're using the LWA 1000 amps.
Yes, absolutely.
And you have this great bass, this beat up bass with all this history, but often amplifiers don't get the same kind of credit as the instruments do. Do you find? I mean, they're equally as important.
Oh, absolutely. You know, and you know, being a professional musician, I'm always on the lookout for gear. And I wasn't even looking for anything, you know, I had my amplifier and everything. And it was by accident that I met Hans Peter online, basically, and we started a conversation. I didn't know anything about Warwick at the time, even though I was born and raised in Germany and I played a lot inside of Germany. But, you know, I also lived like the last 20 years in the States, so I was a little bit out of the loop. And so, you know, Hans Peter was so kind to invite me to one of these events as a special guest. And that's when I discovered the LWA 1000, including the speaker cabinets that we're looking at over here. So I really fell in love with them for two reasons. Like, number one, I love the sound. I'm not a fan of extreme EQ. So there are certain amplifiers where you need to be a scientist to get it just to sound like your instrument would in the headphones, right? Not with this amp. You plug it in, it sounds like your instrument. And then you can add or take away whatever you want. There's incredible power in this little machine over here. It also has these two dedicated channels. So it was perfect for me because I play fretted and fretless. So I can dial in my sound on both instruments. I don't have to touch a thing. And then the big plus is weight. It's lightweight and it's small. And that to me is the future, because we move around a lot. And you know, speaking about moving around a lot, I found out that Warwick was the first carbon neutral company in the business. And I was highly impressed by that. So I'm kind of proud to represent Warwick as an artist, because I think the climate issue is actually the most important issue there is right now. Even though it's so huge that it's almost like you don't have a personal relationship to it immediately, but I'm very thankful, you know, for what Warwick has done. And now I can already say I've had the chance to test this gear for a couple of years. I've never had any problems with it. So it's nice and robust, and my back is happy because I can, you know, carry it in and out of the van without freaking out my back. Also, I like the consistency that Hans Peter has put together by creating this community of bassists once a year. And so many things branch out from here. Many things happen at the camp that carry over into the lives of these musicians. So I think it's a perfect balance of, you know, technical proficiency, the fine craftsmanship, and the social component, you know, that makes the overall bass community flourish and go on into the future.
Great. Well, we're really pleased you came over, Kai. Just want to say thank you again for taking the time to chat.
Right on.